Hello and welcome back to the fourth episode of the Most Traveled Podcast. As always, I'm Joe Altaffer, back with my dad, Bill Altaffer, and today we want to talk about a specific place in Antarctica. So to start off, who goes to Antarctica?
Well, I think it's people that have been to the other six continents, and they're looking for something different and to complete their continent list, if they have such a thing. But or are there people that are interested in birds and the exotic part of what Antarctica provides?
Because it's definitely not a place that the average person goes to.
No, it isn't. I don't know what the figures are now. I went back in the early 90s, so that's close to 30 years ago. So ships have been going, more ships have been going. Larger cruise-type ships have gone, which I don't recommend. But I don't know what the numbers are.
So why would people go? Why'd you go?
Well, I went because I wanted to see what it was like. I talked to a friend up in Mammoth who spent a year there working at McMurdo Sound for the American government. I think he was a truck driver or something like that. And he spent a whole year there. I thought that's really amazing because, you know, once it closes down for the winter, our summer, you're there. You're not going anywhere. And it's dark, I guess, 22 hours a day.
Wow.
So to experience something like that, I didn't want to ever experience that, but I just thought I was fascinated by someone who had been to Antarctica. And then in the early 90s, tours started going there. Cruises started going there.
So is that how you got there, through a cruise?
It was. And that's how I got associated with a company that I worked for at least 15 years, called Marine Expeditions. It was out of Toronto, and it was a Canadian company, obviously, started by Sam Blythe. He, right after the Soviet Union broke up, he got the idea to lease Soviet, now Russian, ships to take them to the Arctic first on tours, and then later to the Antarctic.
So for your trip in particular, did you take an icebreaker down there?
Took an ice class rather than an icebreaker. So
what does that mean?
It means it has a hull that can break through 2 or 3 feet of ice.
So that's what's called an ice class?
Yeah.
Okay.
There's a time maybe we'll talk about in our podcast when I did the Northeast Passage and the North Pole on a real icebreaker, in fact, a nuclear icebreaker. But this was an ice class called the Academic Iofi. And it, like all the ships that Sam leased over the years, they were formerly spy ships, spying on mostly the United States using different methods.
Mm-hmm. So how long are these trips typically?
The shortest is about 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks. And the kind I think is the best is something like a month, because you want to, after you've done the continent of Antarctica, you want to see the island of South Georgia and the Falkland Islands before you come back. This is if you're leaving on the South America side to get to Antarctica, which is the most popular way to go. There is the Australian side, as well as the South African, but nobody does that.
How come?
There's no place to go there except Marion Island that belongs to, and that's a research station. They don't want tourists there.
So it's not something that tourists do going from Australia?
They do go from Australia, but not from South Africa.
Oh, not from South Africa.
They go from Australia to see the emperor penguin. Because his colony is larger on the on that side of Antarctica.
So is he exclusive to that region, I guess?
Yes, I think I have heard that they have found some emperors that you can reach from the South American side, but I think I'm a little gray on that. I'm not sure. I don't think that's, excuse me, done very often.
So did you see any penguins when you went on your trip?
Absolutely. And
how were they?
They smell,
really,
but they're beautiful.
Are they in big groups, like 1,000 of them, or?
Yeah, they're in their herds, or I forget what the name of a group of penguins is. But what's coming to mind, and I have some great photographs, is on the island of South Georgia, and where Shackleton's buried. We know about this Shackleton expedition. If we don't, it's worth reading.
I do not. Well, tell me more about it.
Well, he was a Brit, and they got stranded down there, and their boat sank, and he made a rescue using his open boat, lifeboat, and he got to South Georgia to get help. South Georgia's an island I suppose it goes up 2,000 or 3,000 feet, and normally there's nobody on the island. When we were there, there was a couple in a sailboat that was running the little museum there in the harbor. But Shackleton's buried there. And
oh, really? So he died there?
And yes.
Oh, gee.
And
wow.
But I think he came back, and then he was brought back and buried there. But my point is that there were rookeries, I think that's penguins, rookeries, of 20, 30, 40,000 all up along the shoreline, all the way up into the mountains. And I got a picture of my friend wearing a bright yellow jacket right in the middle of the group. And, you know, it's fantastic to watch these animals waddle along in their little tuxedos. But the smell is extremely strong.
Extremely bad. Okay. So I've heard that some people go on this trip as a way to maybe lose weight.
That could be from the roughness of the sea. When you're crossing from South America, you got the Straits of Magellan and the Drake Passage, where all the currents of the Pacific merge into the Atlantic, and you get some of your most
rough waters,
horrendous waves in the world are there. Yeah, but you know, these ships that race around the world, sometimes they get in trouble there. And then tourists being stupid as they can be sometimes, like perhaps the people that sue their travel agent because they went to Kauai and it rained the whole week. People I've heard sued once because they went across the Drake on an Antarctic trip and it was smooth as glass.
And they wanted the roughness.
And they'd read about this.
They
Straits
wanted it
of Magellan.
To be like Indiana
they want
Jones.
To experience it. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure nothing happened related to that. But what I recommend is, just like Alaska, the smaller the ship, in this instance, the better, because you can make more landings. Probably after 2-3 days when you reach, if you go out of Ushuaia, which is the most common way, Argentina on the island, Terra del Fuego, once you get to Antarctica, you can usually make 2-3 landings a day, and you do that in Zodiac boats, rubber boats that Jacques Cousteau designed 50 years ago, those rubber boats. They're the easiest to get people ashore and back and handle the rough seas. Whereas I've heard of larger cruise-type ships going to Antarctica now, and they can't make the number of landings that a small ship can.
So let's segue a little bit back to your specific trip. So you went back in the 1990s. So how'd you get there? Where'd you fly to?
Well, we all had to get to Buenos Aires, and then Rio Gallegos and Rio Grande were two stops, I remember, on the flight out of Buenos Aires, and then to Ushuaia on the island of Tierra del Fuego, Island of Fire, because of the volcanoes. And then we boarded the ship there, which in this case, again, was the Academic Iafi, and probably had 150 passengers. And we took off for Antarctica.
So how were the first couple of days at sea?
They were rough. It was doable, though. It wasn't too extreme, but it's what I expected.
And how long did it take from where you were to get to Antarctica by sea?
Well, like I said, 2.5 to 3 days.
And then 3 days? Okay.
Yeah.
And so when you get there, are you traveling to different spots around Antarctica? Or you're just kind of
There's a couple
around?
Islands that we'd go to, and then we'd make a landing right on the continent itself.
Okay.
And, you know, you get in your Zodiac boats, I guess, 10, 12 people per per boat. And the Zodiac driver has to be quite experienced to handle the waves and currents, etc., because it could be dangerous. There have been people who drowned doing these trips when the Zodiac flipped over or they fell out of it. And then you're wearing your life jacket. And in the beginning, people would use the rubber boots that were on the boat. But then later, I think they told people to buy their own and bring them on the trip. So you got to allow that in your luggage, these big rubber boots, to step ashore. If you have tennis shoes or something like that, you're going to step into the ocean. You're going to have wet feet. But
so you got to actually kind of walk on that ice.
Yes, but mostly we get off where it's rocky and slippery.
Oh, okay.
And then you walk up onto the ice. Everybody would put all their life jackets in one pile, but I remember usually I'd keep mine on because it gave me a little bit more warmth.
Mm-hmm. So, okay. So,
and you would see stations like the Chilean station where they'd had an encampment for a dozen years doing research. So there are
a few outposts out there.
There are a few outposts. Obviously, nobody there. And it was a great experience.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't there a lady you had traveled with that was looking to swim with them?
Well, when you get on these ships...
With penguins, right?
Ships require, by law, over 12 passengers to have a doctor, kind of an international thing. So on our ship, which was Russian, they would change these names later to anglicized names to sell them in brochures, but they're Russian ships. She was the ship's doctor, and she got off almost every stop we had. And this first time I looked at her, she was rather portly, and she went down to the water's edge there, and I'm looking at her, and there were sea lions in the water swimming around and mm-hmm. penguins on the shore. She strips down to her bathing suit, and she goes out into the icy water and starts swimming. And it wasn't one of these dunk things like they do at the North Pole in a hole, and then everybody
gets
out.
She just went straight into the open water.
She spent a half hour in the water.
Really?
Swimming back and forth and back and forth.
Was it cold? Did you reach your hand in it?
I'm on the shore wearing my life jacket, plus down parka, plus.
Can you even
layered.
Spend 30 minutes in Arctic water?
I can't.
I feel like you'd get hypothermia.
So I thought about her. If I had to go to her on the ship for a medical problem, she would probably recommend keel haul.
What's that mean?
Well, during the pirate days, to punish somebody, they'd tie them to a rope and drag them underneath the ship.
Oh,
so they pull from one side, and all the barnacles of the ship would cut you.
That's supposed to help you?
I mean,
or
well, if you went in and you complained about your nose cold, I mean, what's she going to tell you? You know, go out on the bow of the ship and take your jacket off. Nobody went to her, I don't think, for any problem.
Tell me a little bit more about this specific trip. What did you see? Where'd you go?
Well, the first encounter, I said, was an island. It was Deception Island, which had been reached by the early explorers to Antarctica. And in that spot, they had hot springs. So you could actually take off whatever you were wearing, big parka, backpacks, things like that.
And you wouldn't have to go in the cold water.
You could get into the hot springs water. And, you know, as soon as you got out, you better put everything back on. But it was not that cold. It was doable. It was no colder than, let's say, being in a ski area during
really?
The winter. Yeah.
So you would expect it to kind of be like Siberia, you know, that Arctic,
right.
Throw the chickens in there, they freeze before they hit the ground type of feel. When you
right.
Think.
But, you know, they say that Antarctica is the coldest place on the face of the earth. And as you go into the interior, and there are mountains that you're looking at that are 2,000 or 3,000, 4,000 feet high in the distance. And then on the beaches, you're seeing rookeries of penguin everywhere.
Are there any other animals out
there? There's sea lions and seals that are trying to escape from the sea lions in the water.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking at the rough sea to see if it's how rough it's getting, because you would go back in groups when the Zodiac filled up. So you, whatever number you arrived on the shore, you didn't have to go back in that boat. And as the seas would pick up to get a smoother ride, less wet ride on the way back to the boat, I would pick and choose when I went back. But, you know, as you walk across these cobblestone type wet rocks, you have to be careful that you don't slip. And the Zodiac driver and maybe an assistant will help you into the Zodiac boat so you don't get wet and you don't slip and hurt yourself. But your walks are probably up to a mile if you want, if you wish, and to, like I said, research stations that have been abandoned by expeditions that mostly were represented by various countries. And so there's the British and the Russian and the Chilean and the American stations. And you could go into the gray buildings of wood that have been weathered by the 100-mile-an-hour winds that it gets in the winter, and you could still see canned food in there, some of them with labels still on it, and you could see a desk and chairs and where these people spent the winter. Because once the winter comes for them, which would be around May, you're not leaving until at least October. If you remember a couple of years ago, there was an American doctor lady who analyzed her own cancer, and she knew she had to get off the island, and I think she survived, but it was off the continent. But it was, once you're there, you're not leaving. The planes don't go in and out of the bases like at the American base at the South Pole and McMurdo Sound. You're there for the duration.
Okay, so what other islands did you see while you were traveling there?
Well, this Deception Island was the first one, and then South Georgia on our way back to Ushuaia. And then we stopped in the Falkland Islands, and this trip we went to Port Stanley, the main island, and there we saw, they have a war museum showing what took place between the Argentinians and the British forces. Because if you remember, they had a Falkland War, and they... When you're at the airport in Buenos Aires, as you go to the airport, you'll see this big sign up on the highway. It says, Malvinas son Argentinas, which means the Falkland Islands belong to them. Still there today, I think. So the generals of Argentina had started this war with the Brits for a bunch of reasons. I think they thought there was oil there and their economy was lagging and it could help them or something, give them some direction. Of course, they lost the war, but they didn't think the British were going to be able to fight it, because the closest the British troops were to Antarctica was up at Ascension Island in the middle of the Atlantic. But in the museum there, the curator was showing us guns and lots of mining. In fact, when the Argentinians knew that Port Stanley was going to fall, they mined the whole island, and they put these mines, and then they tore up the directions or the locations, the map of where all these mines are. So today, you'll be out there, and there's just thousands of sheep herding across the Falkland Islands, and then you'll hear a blast, and then one of them stepped on a mine, one of the sheep, and they're
dead. Oh my gosh.
And so they have a group of British mine extractors that stay there, and they try to go out and find these mines still to this day. It's a real problem.
That's crazy.
One story I thought was pretty funny was we're in the museum. Whether this is true or not, this is what the curator said. You would see little bridges outside of Port Stanley, and it would say built by the number 12th Regiment of the Gurkhas. Now, the Gurkhas, if you know, are the Nepalese soldiers that the British trained hundreds of years ago, and they really are some of the greatest fighters, if not the best, military unit in the world. They were in Italy during World War II, and they're unbelievable. They're the ones that have that knife with the curve on the end, and they're silent, and they're very stealth-like. Well, anyway, they built all these bridges, and so this one Gurkha officer said to his captain in the British forces, "Sir, why are you using us to build bridges when we're the best fighters in the world?" So supposedly the captain yelled over to the Argentinian troops, "Tomorrow we're sending the Gurkhas." And supposedly that was the end of the war, and the Argentinians surrendered because they knew what the Gurkhas were all about.
So, how much would it cost, would you imagine, for the average person to go to Antarctica?
I think now it's probably in the $15,000 to $20,000 range.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so definitely not the cheapest trip to go on.
No, and it gets higher all the time.
Do you need a visa to visit Antarctica?
No.
No? Okay.
But there are treaties that forbid, say, nuclear icebreakers or nuclear ships from going into the territory. Apparently, the Russians would love to get in there and extract, and the
All
Chinese,
their minerals,
all the minerals. But right now, it's not happening, thank God. And so it's preserved.
So when would you say is the best time to go there? Time of the
It
year?
has to be in our winter. It's
In
the
our
best time to
winter?
go is November, December, January is excellent, February is excellent. March, it's getting towards the end of their it's the fall for their.
What happened at the end of your trip?
Well, this was very unique in the sense that or it was unique. We almost were stuck there for 2 months or more, and it was unforeseen. So we're in Port Stanley. The next situation was a couple of days there, and then sail across a little stretch of the Atlantic to Ushuaia, and then board planes back to Buenos Aires and go home. So I'm out on the deck, and I'm looking down in the harbor, and I see the Zodiac going across the harbor to the governor's mansion, and our captain of the ship is in a white Napoleonic type costume with a hat. It looks like something Napoleon would have worn, and he's got his sword at his waist, and he's standing out on the front of the Zodiac, and I'm going, "What is that all about?" And then soon, some of the crew come up, and they're passing out copies of this piece of paper that they had, the original, they had stamped onto the mast of the ship, and it said, "In the name of Her Majesty, Queen of England, Sovereign of Scotland, Wales, Ireland, I hereby impound this ship." And we're going, "What's the deal?" And this is on a Friday. We have New York doctors who have operations they're going to perform the following week that are, they need to get home. And so the ship, Russian registry, about 5 years earlier was in Hamburg, and they had repairs done to the ship, and they never paid for them. Well, the lawyers for this, the merchant marine of the Germans, got the British to impound this ship in Antarctica on a Friday, knowing the stress it would put on everybody so they could collect what was owed to them. So he goes over to get released from the governor, and the governor says, "No, the boat's staying here." So what I'm trying to tell you is, when you go on these kind of exotic trips, you may have to think about, with Antarctica, different than anywhere else in the world, you may be stuck there. And you could have been. There were people that ended up there 2 months because what happened was they didn't know that what we're going to do. So the officers of the ship said, "Okay, anybody here want to just stay on the boat?" And there was a 20, 30% of the people, let's say, were retirees from Florida who, they're going to be there, they're going to get their meals, and they're going to get bored as hell at Port Stanley, but they said, "Okay, we'll stay to the last."
Okay.
I was just recently married, and my wife's at home, and I was pretty good friends with the guys on the ship, so I managed to be the first one off. Mm-hmm. I said, I got to go home. You know, my wife needs me and stuff. So what they did was, nobody could come from Argentina to help us, because technically, like with the United States and Korea, North Korea, they're still at war. Mm-hmm. They still have a war relationship. Now, what we ended up doing is getting a small airplane from Chile, permission to fly over Argentina, out into the Atlantic for 2 or 3 hours in rough seas, land at Port Stanley, and take off 3 people a day. So this small plane only held 4 people. So you got the pilot, so they could take 3 people off a day. So I said there was like 150 people on the ship. It took 2 months. Every day this plane would make this, you know, and so.
So some people just hung out there.
Yeah, and wow. What I understood was the last person to come off the ship was the Argentinian cook, the chef, and they put him in chains.
Why?
Because they're still at war. They hate each other. God. And so they put him on the plane. So, and plus, I guess he had to stay there and cook for the people that were on the ship. So that was the academic IOFI, and I made it home on time, but it was a close one.
Yeah. Well, that looks like that's it for our 4th episode of the Most Traveled Podcast. We hope you enjoyed hearing a little bit about our travels to Antarctica, and we hope that you can join us for next week as we delve into more places. Thanks again.